गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल ऑफ यू. इंडियन सोसाइटी फॉर
दीपक, यू नीड टू शेयर योर वीडियो एंड म्यूट योरसेल्फ.
इंडियन सोसाइटी फॉर वेटनरी सर्जरी वेलकम्स ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स एंड टुडेज स्पीकर डॉक्टर नवनीत सिंह. कार्डियक डिजीजेस आर considered to be the second important disorders in the veterinary practice and are being diagnosed with increased frequency. Increased expensive life expectancy in the dogs due to advances in veterinary medicine had led to the cardiac diseases becoming very common in geriatric dogs, and therefore echocardiography plays an important role in the diagnosis of these diseases and disorders. Dr. Navneet Singh, working as a professor and became in charge head of Department of Veterinary Surgery and Radiology, College of Veterinary Sciences, Gadwasu, Ludhiana on 16th September 2020. He completed his BBSc, MBSc and PhD degree in the Department of Surgery and Radiology from Punjab Agricultural University. He has 18 years of experience in teaching, research and extension. He has been associated with 9 research projects and has authored about 52 research articles in peer-reviewed journals and 46 extension articles. He received a visiting associate professor fellowship from UC Davis, California, US. The department being a center of advanced faculty training of ICR, he aimed to maintain the numero uno status of department and intends to take the department forward with the help and support of other faculty members of the department. Dr. Navneet Singh started his career from the post of extension and arose to the post of professor in extension department and has worked in the department of teaching veterinary clinical complex since last 4 years. He has worked for the livestock farmers community of Punjab and is well acquainted with the problems being faced by the farmers and cat owners of the Punjab. He also made considerable devotion in standardization and application of echocardiography for management of cardiovascular diseases in veterinary patients. Looking to his considerable experience in the field of echocardiography, I request Dr. Navneet Singh to deliver today's webinar on basics of echocardiography in canine. Dr. Navneet Singh,
over to Dr. Nadir. Kindly unmute yourself.
So, has my screen been shared?
No, not yet. Yes.
Now you're fine?
Yeah, all fine. All ready to go.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So today is the last Saturday of 2020, and I hope the new year will bring a new change in the scenario which is going on all around the world. So we may get a vaccine for the COVID-19. So I hope that 2021 will be a better year as compared to 2020. So now let's start with the today's topic, which is basics of canine echocardiography.
Dr. Nandi, some way we are not able to share your screen, so can you just reshare it once?
Okay.
Unshare and then reshare.
Okay. Just a minute. Is it okay now?
No. Not yet.
No.
No.
now?
No.
Fine.
Yes.
Okay.
All good to go.
Everyone. The today's topic is basics of canine echocardiography. So, for today's lecture, I have taken some images or graphics from the a book by Boone, and a few of images have been taken from the internet. So now, what echocardiography is? Now, echocardiography basically is nothing but the ultrasound only, but it is ultrasound of heart. It is slightly different from the normal ultrasound, and the only difference is that we are using a special type of transducer as compared to the normal ultrasonography. So rest, everything is same. That is, the transducer is emitting the ultrasound. They are going into the body and they strike the organs. They are reflected back and again taken by the transducer, and the resulting image is formed on the screen. So rest, everything is same. Only difference is between the transducer, which is a sort of, you can say, specific one. So rest properties are almost same. That is, it is non-invasive. The advantage of echocardiography is it has ability to assess both the structure as well as the function of the heart. Whereas if we talk about the ECG, electrocardiogram, it only gives us the functional disability of the, or functional, you can say, a change in the heart. Whereas the echocardiography, it gives both structural as well as functional change in the heart. So the expenses are lower and there is no change in the physiological state of the patient or the animal. So when we are doing the echocardiography, so there will be no change in the physiological status of the animal. Now, what are the indications for doing the echocardiography? So when we want to see the internal cardiac structures, that is, we want to see the different chambers, left atrium, left ventricle, right atrium, right ventricle, the different valves, mitral valve, aortic valve, or the tricuspid valve. So we can use, in those cases, we can use the echocardiography. And we want to evaluate the function of the heart. That is, we want to evaluate the functioning of the different chambers or the valves. We can use those. Then we can go for a series of evaluations. Like if we have given some medication or we want to see the effect of some medication, we can go for a series of evaluations. We can use it for detection of heart murmur, and the main is to see the defects, if any are present in the heart, which can be, these defects can be valvular or stenotic lesions in the valves, the shunts if they are present, any myocardial abnormalities like DCM, that is dilated cardiomyopathy, then if any masses are present in the chambers, or if any pericardial effusions are there. So we can all detect or diagnose these with the help of echocardiography. And the last is to monitor the response to therapy. That is, we have already diagnosed some problem in the heart, and after taking the initial data or initial pictures, after giving the therapy, say after 2 days, 3 days, or after a week, we can again go for the echocardiography and see the changes or response to the therapy, that is, whether it is the animal is responding to the therapy or not. So how to or where to perform the echocardiography? So we have to palpate the point of the elbow and the chest, means where elbow contacts the chest, and then we have to look for the point of PMI. PMI is point of maximal impulse. That is, when you put their hand on the side of on the chest cavity near the fourth or fifth intercostal space, you will find the heartbeat. And the place where you will find the maximum heartbeat, you will have to shave around that area. We have to shave about 4 by 4 inch, 4 by 4 square inch of the area. So in dogs, basically we have to they shave the right side from 4 to 6 intercostal space, and the last side, left side from 4 to last rib. The clipped area should extend from costochondral junction up to the sternum, particularly in the left side, on the left side. So patient positioning. The echocardiography can be performed in the standing animal as well as in the lateral recumbency. But the lateral recumbency is preferred particularly in dogs and cats. The reason being, when the animal is put in the lateral recumbency, the heart, due to its weight, it displaces the lungs and comes almost in the contact of the thoracic wall. So when we perform the echocardiography, we are not encountering any lung in between the heart and the thoracic wall. See, the echocardiography is performed by positioning the animal in the lateral recumbency, and there is a hole or gap in the table so that we can put the transducer from that. So when we put the animal in lateral recumbency, the lower side, we have to perform the echocardiography from the lower side of the animal. Now the transducer selection, it depends on the size of the patient. For cats and small dogs, we can use 7.5 megahertz of transducer. Transducer having 7.5 megahertz frequency. For small to medium dogs, we can use 5 megahertz frequency, and for large dogs, we can use 3.5 to 5 megahertz. So higher the frequency, or rather smaller the breed, we need higher the frequency of the transducer. So as I have already told, there is a slight difference in the transducer of the echocardiography machine, or this echocardiographic transducer has a reference mark on it. This reference mark can be anything. It may be a protrusion on one side, it may be a dot on one side of the this transducer, or it can be a light on one side of the transducer. So this will act as a reference mark. So this helps in determining or examining the heart, and we can easily guess from which side the left atrium is there, or on which side the left ventricle is there. So various terminologies are used regarding these transducers. So one is crystals or face. That is the this is the part or the end of the transducer from which the sound waves are emitted. Then rotate, this is to twist the transducer either clockwise or counterclockwise. Then lift, drop and fan. These are the different terminology used to lift up or lift down the cord of the tail, and fanning is just the lifting and dropping of tail of a transducer. So without changing the location, mean we will keep the tip of the or face of the this transducer at one place only, and then we have to lift up or lift down the this tail or cord of the transducer. And last is point, which is the part that is which is the transducer faced towards the anatomical structure, or which touches the thoracic wall. So you can see, this is the face of the transducer. So we can rotate the transducer. We have to keep this point there only, but on the part of the thoracic wall, but we will just rotate the transducer either clockwise or anticlockwise. And then is fanning. Here again, we will keep the transducer at one place only, but we can fan it on this side or on this side. So there are some other terms used which are very rarely used, like sweeping, sliding, blocking, pressure, etc. Now we come to the basic echocardiography. So basically the echocardiography is divided into three parts, that is the two dimensional imaging or 2D imaging, M mode imaging and Doppler. So 2D imaging, if this gives a real-time anatomically correct image of the heart. That is, we can see the different chambers of the heart, we can see the walls of the heart, and we can even see the pumping of the heart. So this is used for assessment of cardiac structure and function. 2D imaging is used for assessment of cardiac structure and function. Then is M mode. M mode is basically iPSC view of the heart, which is used for quantification of chamber characteristics. That is, through the 2D image, we pick a part from which this sound wave or ultrasound waves, they are passing through a particular line. So that particular line will be shown as a one-dimensional graphic picture, so which will represent the different parts of the heart from which that line is passing. And third is Doppler, which is used for evaluation of blood flow, like velocity and direction. So see, this is a two-dimensional imaging. So we can see the four chambers of the heart. So this is left atrium, left ventricle, right atrium, right ventricle. So these are the mitral valves. Now M mode. M mode is, this is a 2D image. Now the in M mode, through this line, we will be seeing the structure in a graphical form. So you can see this is the right atrium. So this part is right atrium. This is represented or presented in a graphic form. This is interventricular septum. This is interventricular septum. This is left ventricle. This is left ventricle. And then is left ventricle posterior wall. This is left ventricle posterior wall. And this bright line is pericardium. So this here is pericardium. So M mode is the graphical representation through a line, or the, you can say, ultrasound, which is passing through a particular line. So this line can be shifted to any side. And third is Doppler echocardiography. So this basically, this Doppler echocardiography, this works on the principle that the blood which is coming towards, or which is going towards the transducer, it has higher frequency, and the blood which is going away from the this transducer, and the sound reflected by that blood will have a lower frequency. So in normal machines, the blood which is coming towards the transducer, it is represented by a red color, and the blood which is going away from the transducer, it is represented by the blue color. But this is again optional. If you want to change or we want to reverse it, it can be done. That is, if we want to represent the blood coming towards the this transducer, it can be represented by blue color, and the blood which is going away from the transducer, it can be represented by red color. But the normal this procedure is, or the normal principle is, that the blood which is coming towards the transducer, it is represented by red color. So the Doppler is basically of two types. It is continuous wave and pulse wave. So for both these, the separate transmitting and receiving crystals are used in the transducer, and the Doppler, it measures blood velocity along a specific axis, not along a spot, and it is capable of measuring high velocity flow. Now the main advantage of pulse Doppler over the continuous Doppler is its ability to provide Doppler shift data selectively from a small segment along the ultrasound beam. So main function of the Doppler is to see if there is any regurgitation in the valvular motion. So it can be in the mitral valve, it can be in the aortic valve, or it can be in the tricuspid valve. So in all these cases, we can apply the Doppler. So we can see if there is any regurgitation that can tell us that the valve is not functioning properly. Now the 2D imaging views. The 2D imaging is taken in right parasternal as well as in left parasternal views. So the right parasternal is taken in the long axis and short axis, whereas the left parasternal is taken, views are taken in long axis, short axis, and apical views. Now, for the right parasternal long axis four chamber view. Basically, the long axis is, again, it has two views. One is right parasternal long axis four chamber view. So in this, the reference mark is pointed towards the shoulder of the animal. When we put the transducer from beneath the thoracic chest, or sorry, thoracic wall, the reference mark, it should point towards the shoulder of the animal, right shoulder of the animal. So the structures which we will see is left atrium, left ventricle, right atrium, right ventricle. One thing to take note is the part which is closer to the transducer. So that will be represented first, or it will be have a shorter image. And whereas the part which is away from the transducer, that will give a bigger image. So the part which is closer to the transducer, it will be having a small image. The part which is away from the transducer, it will have a bigger image. So this can be seen graphically also, that the part, this is the position of the transducer in the long axis four chamber view. So we can see right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, and left ventricle. So this is the image, left atrium, mitral valve, and left ventricle. So in this, we can see a thickened mitral leaflet. So this is the defect which can be appreciated in this image. So this is basically long axis four chamber view only. So these are the other two chambers. So here the mitral valve, it is thickened, the leaflet of the mitral valve, this is thickened. So this will lead to regurgitation, because when the mitral valve is thickened, so it will not close properly. So whenever the blood will is pumped from left atrium to left ventricle, and when the during systole the leaflets, they close the mitral valve, the sum of the blood, it will come back. So which can be seen with the help of Doppler. Then just by slightly rotating the transducer, we can see the right parasternal long axis LVOT view. LVOT is left ventricular outflow tract view. So left ventricular outflow is aorta. So in this, the aorta, in this view, the aorta will come into the picture. So we can see the left atrium, left ventricle, and aorta, and mainly right ventricle. So just see the this part, the graphical representation. So there is a slight difference in the angle of the transducer. Just compare it with the this part and see this. So there is a slight angulation of the transducer. So the slight angulation, this will bring the aorta into the view. Then comes the right parasternal short axis images. For right parasternal short axis images, what we have to do, we have to rotate the transducer. We will keep the transducer at that place only from where we have taken the long axis views. We will just rotate it at 90 degrees. So when we will rotate it at 90 degrees, we will get the short axis images. Just see. So in right parasternal short axis views, we have to move from the apex to the base of the heart. So we will see different structures, like at the first is papillary muscles. So you can see, or you can appreciate, at this part of the heart, the beam is passing from the this part of the heart. So we will see the left ventricle and the papillary muscles. So this view is also called mushroom view. So just see the position of transducer with respect to the heart. So this part, the transducer, when it is directed towards the apex, we will see the left ventricle and the papillary muscles. Then slightly panning motion, we move the or angle, we make the angle towards the. So this view, this can help us in detecting the fractional shortening, and if there is any DCM, that is, we can see the left ventricular diameter from this. We can measure the left ventricular diameter by using M mode from this view. So for M mode, what we have to do, sorry, for fractional shortening, we have to take the internal left ventricular internal diameter at diastole and left ventricular internal diameter at systole. So we subtract the left ventricular internal diameter at systole from the left internal diameter at diastole and divide it by the left internal diameter at diastole. So this will give us the fractional shortening. So if the fractional shortening is more than 45%, that means the animal is having a dilated cardiomyopathy or the left ventricular ventricle is dilated. So in this case, you can see the fractional shortening is 50%. That means the left ventricular ventricle is enlarged in this case. So this is a case of DCM. And by slightly panning the transducer towards the base of the heart, we can see the caudate tendineae. Then again, when we slightly fan the transducer more, we can see the mitral valves. So the mitral valves, they can be seen. See, these are the mitral valves. So this typical view is called fish mouth view. So if we can recall that this is just like if the fish is opening and closing its mouth. Then this mitral valve view, this is used basically be used for calculating the EPSS, E-point septal separation. Then heart base. Then when we fan the transducer even more, just see the direction of transducer now. So then aorta and left atrium, they are both seen in this view. So this view is used to take the LA aorta ratio. So just see here, this is aorta and this is left atrium. So we can measure the left atrium and aorta at their maximum diameters. Where we see the maximum diameter, we have to take that part, that area. So the ratio of LA aorta, it should be 0.8 to 1.2. So if it is between 0.8 to 1.2, that means the animal is normal or the heart is normal. Nothing, none of these two are enlarged. If the ratio is less than 0.8 or more than 1.2, that means either the left atrium is enlarged or aorta is enlarged, whatever may be the scene. So that means there is some pathology is there. Then the fifth is heart base, that is the pulmonary artery. So here we can see the pulmonary artery, that is the right ventricular outflow tract, can be seen in this image or in this view. So we have to angle the transducer even more than the LA aorta part. So this 2D or these short axis images, these can be used or these can be seen, and they can help in detecting the pericardial effusions also. See the heart, it is almost floating in the fluid. You can see or you can appreciate the all this around the heart. This is heart. So the effusions Some effusions are already always present in the around the heart, but when the column is very big, then the we can say that the, there are pericardial effusions present in the around the heart. Now the left parasternal apical images. We come to left parasternal side. On left parasternal side, the main side, the main images are from the apical images. The apical images are again of two types: four chamber view and five chamber view. In this, the transducer is kept almost parallel to the sternum. That is, you have to keep the transducer almost beneath the apex of the heart. Just see the positioning. See, this is the apex of the heart. So the transducer is placed just below the apex of the heart. See here. So that the mitral valve and tricuspid valve, they are almost in the line of the ultrasound. So this view is basically used to see the regurgitation. This is the best view to see the regurgitation in the mitral valve or in the tricuspid valve. So again, just by slightly changing the angle, we can also bring the aorta into the picture. Just see, the aorta has come into the picture. So now we can see the functioning of all the three valves. That is the tricuspid valve, aortic valve, and mitral valve. So this is the method by which we put the Doppler ultrasound over the aortic flow. So this is the aorta. So here we have put the Doppler over it. So if there is mixing of the color, see, the here only the red and blue color is being seen, so which are in between this bar. So when we see more of the color which is on the extremities, that means there is more of the mixing or the blood is coming back. So that is called the regurgitation. So when the color is mostly from the middle of this bar, that means the valves, they are normal and there is no regurgitation. Then is left parasternal long axis LVOT. This is almost similar to the right parasternal long axis LVOT. Then the another view is left parasternal long axis right ventricular outflow. So in this we can see the pulmonary walls and even the bifurcation of the pulmonary artery into the left and right pulmonary arteries. So in this view, we can detect the regurgitation in the pulmonary valve if any is there. So we can put some Doppler here, so we can see whether there is any regurgitation in this valve or not. Then comes the M mode. So M mode, as I have told, it is the graphical picturization through a part from which the line of ultrasound or through a line from which the ultrasound is passing in the heart. So just see. So this is the heart, this hole is heart. So the ultrasound is passing through this line. So along this line, you can't see, there is no tricuspid valve, there is no mitral valve coming near this line, and no aortic valve is coming near this line. So what we will see, this is the right ventricular valve. This is right ventricle. This is represented by here. This is interventricular septum. This is interventricular septum. And this is left ventricle. So this is whole left ventricle. And this is left ventricular valve. This is left ventricular valve. So this is at diastolic when the mitral valves are open. So same structure will be seen at systole. That is, there is no change. The left ventricle, right ventricular wall, right ventricle, interventricular septum, left ventricle, and left ventricular wall. So M mode echocardiography can be used in the right parasternal short axis view, right? So here you can see that we have from here to here, this is the interventricular septum at diastole. Then from here to here. This is the left ventricular internal diameter at diastole. And from here to here, this part. This is the left ventricular posterior wall at diastole. So this whole part is at diastole, and at systole, this is the internal ventricular septum at systole. This is left ventricular internal diameter at systole, and this is the left ventricular posterior wall at systole. So these will give us the ejection fraction and stroke volume, etc. Now, when we change the angle of the transducer, so now this line is passing through the tricuspid valve as well as it is touching the mitral valves. So you can appreciate from here, same structure, right ventricular valve. This is a tricuspid valve. Then see here, this is the opening of the mitral valve, and this is the closing of the mitral valve. Again, it opens, it closes. It opens, it closes. So the beam which is passing through this part, it is showing the graph in this manner, that there is a tricuspid valve there opening and closing, then mitral valve it is opening and it is closing. Similarly at systole, right, here it is closing, the mitral valve it is opening. Then when we further change the angle to the aortic valve, so now what will happen, the right ventricular valve, right atrium, then aorta. This is aorta, and these are aortic valves. So this represent open aortic valves, and this is closed aortic valve. When single line is seen, again they have opened, they have closed, and left atrium. So similarly at systole, when the beam is passing through the aortic valve. Then color Doppler, it is mainly used to see the regurgitation. Now regurgitation mainly is seen on this mitral valves, and this can happen due to two or three conditions. One is when the mitral valve, they are having, just as I have shown you, the mitral valve has a thickening, or there can be any growth, or if the chamber has increased. So in all the conditions, the valve, it will not close properly. So there will be some back shunting of the blood. So this will cause regurgitation, and that will be shown in this way. That is more color which is on the extremities, yellow and frozy or light blue color. So here we are showing the left left atrium to left ventricle mitral valves and aortic valves. So one valve is showing red color, and on the other side the blood flow is shown in the blue color. So this is going away from a transducer, this is coming towards the transducer, this blood. So here is this video of a regurgitation. Just see how much mixing of the color from the extremities is there. So this was a case basically having a large atrium. It has an enlarged atrium. But this is another case which is having a mitral regurgitation. Now we come to assessing the cardiac functions. So for systolic function, we need to have fractional shortening, ejection fraction, and systolic time intervals. And for diastolic function, we need to have inflow velocities and diastolic time intervals. Now these fractional shortening, ejection fraction, etc., these are self-calculated by the software. When we put the dimensions of the left interventricular septum, then left ventricle and posterior wall at diastole as well as systole. So the software itself calculates the least flexion shortening and ejection fraction. So this is the way that is we can pass measure the these dimensions using the M mode. So this is the left ventricle wall thickness. This is interventricular septum and this is posterior wall. In dogs, these are almost of the same size. Interventricular septum and posterior wall, these are almost of the same thickness. Whereas in horses, if you talk of horses, the interventricular septum, this is almost double the thickening of the posterior wall. So we have to be species specific. So in the dogs, the interventricular septum and posterior wall, they should be almost of equal thickness, right? So fractional shortening is this distance minus this distance, that is the left ventricular internal diameter at diastole minus left ventricular internal diameter at systole divided by the left ventricular internal diameter at diastole. So this will give us the fractional shortening. So in dogs, it is between 28 to 45. In normal, I mean the normal value is 28 to 45%. So if it is more, that means either the heart is not pumping properly or there is the enlargement of the left ventricle. So left ventricular internal diameter, it is measured at the start of the or at the onset of the QRS complex. So we have to measure from here, from where the dip in the diameter has started. Whereas the left ventricular internal diameter at systole, it is measured at the lowest point of the septum from here. So these are the points from where we have to make the calculations. Then is the EPSS. EPSS is E point septal separation. E point septal separation means when the mitral valve, it has opened fully, say like in this image. So this is the place from where the valve has opened fully. And this is the interventricular septum. So the distance between the interventricular septum and the E point, that is the when the mitral valve is fully open. So this distance is the EPSS, E point septal separation. So in normal dogs, it should be less than 1 centimeter. In normal dogs, some books say it is 0.8 centimeter and some books say it is 1 centimeter. So we take it as 1 centimeter normally. So if it is less than 1 centimeter, it is normal. If it is zero or if it is very much decreased, so that indicates concentric hypertrophy. If it is very much decreased, it indicates concentric hypertrophy. And if it is increased or it is more than 1 centimeter, it indicates either DCM, that is dilated cardiomyopathy, means the chamber or left ventricle has enlarged. So the wall has gone away from the E point, or the mitral valve, it is not opening properly. So this could be due to thickening of the mitral valve. So either of these two can lead to, you can say, increased EPSS. So you can see from here, the in this case, the EPSS is 0.48 centimeter. We have calculated from two different points. In both the cases, it has come out to be 0.48 centimeter. So this indicates a normal heart. If it had been more than 1 centimeter, so it would have indicated either dilated cardiomyopathy or there would have been some, you can say, fault in the valve of the mitral valve. So that's all. Now the topic is open for discussion, please.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर. सर फ्यू क्वेश्चंस आर देयर.
यस ओके
सर. एनी बुक यू रिकमेंड फॉर स्टडीइंग द इकोकार्डियोग्राफी.
या इट इज बेटर इकोकार्डियोग्राफी बाय बून. दिस इज वेरी गुड एंड वेरी मींस सिंपली रिटन बुक वेरी इलस्ट्रेटिव बुक. सो यू कैन यूज बेटर इकोकार्डियोग्राफी बाय बून.
Whether we can perform echocardiography in bovines also?
Yes, yes, we are performing. We are performing in bovine, in equine, and in dogs.
So the criteria for these study remains same or somewhat
yes,
different?
The basic structure is same, but in equine and in bovine you have to perform it in standing animals, whereas in dogs or in cats. It is preferred that we put them in the lateral recumbency.
Sir, any features are required in the ultrasonography machine for performing the echocardiography?
No. Additional you have need to have a echocardiography probe with that. Means all the machines with normal ultrasound machines, they can have a echocardiography probe. We have to means buy it separately along with the machine. The machine is normal, means we are having the same machine in which we perform the normal ultrasound as well as the echocardiography. The probes are different.
Okay, sir. Then, sir, for any pathological condition, what would you suggest? Whether echo is more better or ECG is better?
Echo is better because you can see both the structural and functional differences or changes. In ECG, you can only see the functional change. So it is better as compared to ECG.
So any breed to breed variation that you observed in ECGs, breed to breed variation within dogs?
Yes, yes. There means all the breeds, the registered breeds, they are having different parameters. But in Boone, the book of Boone, they have given a generalized weight-wise distribution, means the range, they, if we want to see the left ventricular internal diameter at diastole. So they have given for a 15 kg dog, the range is from this to this centimeter or this millimeter. And for a 30 kg dog, the range is from this to this. Otherwise, the research paper, they are available on most of the registered breeds, say Doberman or your German Shepherds, Labradors, all these, they are having different papers which have standardized their echocardiographic parameters in dogs.
Another question is specific to equines. What frequency transducers are used in equines?
So as I already told, the bigger the animal, the lower frequency you have to use. So in equine, you have to use 2 to 3 megahertz transducer.
Any specific reference do you recommend for bovine ECG? Any author or specific researcher?
No, means Dr. Chandan Singh, my student, he has done work on standardizing the echocardiographic parameters in buffaloes and Indian cows. So that hasn't been published yet. So otherwise, at least in buffalo, there is no literature available which have standardized the conditions at here. So maybe when the Dr. Chandan Singh's paper is published, then you can use that as a reference.
Okay. The last question, sir. What variation do you see in cattle and buffalo as far as ECG is concerned?
There is not much variation in cattle and buffalo. The only difference is that the wall of the cattle is somewhat even the thinner as compared to the heart valve of the buffalo.
Okay. Right, sir. That brings us to the end of the session. We thank you on behalf of ISVS for a session on ECG just after Christmas and before New Year. So a time when most of the people are more busy with the families. Thank you for giving time for the webinar. Thank you to all the audience for being there and being a part of the webinar series. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.